This video is brought to you by SucceedSchool.com. With complete lessons and resources, assessments, learning plans and schemes of work for students, parents and teachers, for revision, for catch-up, or just to get ahead in class, visit SucceedSchool.com now for your free trial lessons. SucceedSchool.com. Learn to succeed.
Hey class, I'm Mr Thornton and I'm going to help you succeed in your GCSE and IGCSE. In this lesson, solids, liquids and gases. This topic was requested by VV6 Gaming. If you've got a topic that you'd like me to cover, then just leave a comment below. At GCSE and IGCSE, there isn't a lot more you need to know beyond what you probably learned back in Year 7 or 8. So let's do a quick recap of the basics first. The three states of matter you need to know about are solids, liquids, and gases. There are actually some other states of matter, but you don't need to know about them at this level, as you rarely encounter them in day-to-day life. This chart shows you the states, including how we move between them. As you can see, heating and cooling are the processes which cause a change of state. Heating a solid like ice will cause it to melt into a liquid, and continuing to heat it will cause it to evaporate into a gas. Cooling this gaseous water will make it condense back into a liquid and then freeze into a solid. A few substances can take a shortcut on this diagram. For example, carbon dioxide will jump straight from a solid to a gas as we heat it. This is called sublimation. You don't need to know any more about it than that. You also need to know how to draw particle model diagrams for each state. Here, the solid has neatly arranged particles all touching. The liquid has randomly arranged particles, which are touching, and the gas has just a few non-touching particles. At this point, I want to highlight the mistakes to avoid here. Firstly, if you have to draw one of these diagrams, draw the particles quite large. It is much faster than drawing 200 tiny circles. Secondly, if you have to draw more than one of these states of matter, or if one is already drawn for you, make sure all the circles in all three states of matter are drawn the same size as each other. Don't rush this bit. It doesn't have to be millimeter perfect, but they need to be more or less the same size. Thirdly, most people get gases and solids right, but mess up liquids. I think this is still often taught incorrectly by some teachers, so please check yourselves on this. It's the most common mistake I see, and so tends to be the most common diagram they ask you to draw. The particles in your liquid should be randomly arranged, but touching. This is wrong, because they aren't touching. This is correct. This is a hugely important concept because this is why we can't squash liquids, but we can squash gases. There isn't really any space between the liquid particles that we can squash them into. Get those particles touching each other. If you're a higher tier student, please be aware that this model does have its limitations. For a start, the particles are not even close to being spherical usually. Also, we're representing them as solid, inelastic spheres, like marbles, which isn't really true either. Plus, the diagram doesn't represent the forces between the particles in any way at all, and that's pretty crucial to how the particles interact. So, it's a simplified model, but it'll do. One way an exam paper might get you to think about states of matter is by giving you a table of data like this. Notice each substance has a melting point and a boiling point. All you really need to be aware of is that if the temperature is below the melting point, then the substance is still frozen solid. If it's between melting and boiling, then it's a liquid. And if the temperature is above boiling, then it's a gas. So, if we have mercury, water, and iron, and the temperature is minus 10 degrees Celsius, then we are above the melting point for mercury, but below the melting point for water and iron, and below the boiling point for all three. This means the mercury has melted at minus 10 degrees Celsius and is now a liquid, but the water and iron are still frozen. At 30 degrees Celsius, both the water and mercury are now liquid, but the iron remains a solid. Heating up to 200 degrees Celsius, we're now above the boiling point for water, so the water becomes a gas. We're still below the boiling point for mercury, so it's still a liquid. And we're still below the freezing point for iron, so it remains a solid. If we raise the temperature to 2000 degrees Celsius, Finally, the iron has melted and is a liquid, and we're well above the boiling point of mercury and water, and they're both gases now. At GCSE, you also need to be aware of what's happening as a substance switches from one state to another. The particles in everything, unless it's cooled to absolute zero, which is basically impossible, the particles in everything are moving. Even in solids, they're vibrating. So our particle diagrams would really look something like this. Even when something seems completely solid, the particles it's made of are vibrating at an atomic level. If we heat the solid, we give the particles more kinetic energy, that's movement energy, and they vibrate more, making the solid expand. In liquids, the particles move over each other freely, which is why liquids can flow. Heating the liquid makes them flow more easily, making the liquid more runny or less viscous. It also tends to make the liquid expand as well. In a gas, heating the particles makes them move faster, bumping into the walls of the container harder and increasing the gas pressure. If the container is flexible, like a balloon, then it will expand. In solids, there are forces between the particles holding them in place. But when we heat the solid, they vibrate so much that they eventually overcome these forces and break the bonds holding them in place. This is what's happening as a substance melts. In a liquid, there are still forces between the particles, but again, as we heat the particles, they move so much that they break the bonds holding them together. This is evaporation. In both cases, we're just putting more energy in the form of heat. This makes the particles move more, and eventually they overcome the forces between them and their neighbours, breaking the bonds and shaking themselves loose of the other particles. When we cool substances, these bonds can reform. You may be wondering how we determine exactly what the freezing or melting point and the boiling or condensing point of a substance is. It's actually pretty simple. If you take a solid, like ice, and heat it strongly and observe and record the temperature over time, you get a graph shaped like this. The temperature rises pretty linearly at first, but then there's a while where it stays constant before rising again. This section of constant temperature is where it's changing from one state to another state of matter. In this case, the solid is changing to a liquid as it melts. We are still heating the ice during this time where the temperature isn't going up. The temperature stops rising for a while there, even though we're still putting heat energy in. But why? It takes energy to break the bonds holding a solid together. The graph is horizontal in this section because all of the extra energy we put in is being used to break bonds rather than to increase the temperature of the substance. Again, all that energy that we're putting in by heating is breaking the bonds here instead of warming things up. That's how we determine exactly what the melting point of a substance is. If we continue to heat our substance, now it's a liquid, the line rises linearly again until we get another section with zero gradient. By the way, you could also describe these sections of the graph as horizontal, but don't say they're flat. Remember, a flat surface could be at any angle. Stick to horizontal, or better yet, zero gradient. As you probably realise, this next zero gradient section is another state change. Because we've already gone from solid to liquid, this must be the one from liquid to gas, as it's at a higher temperature. If we allowed our gas to cool again, we'd see the same behaviour in reverse. On this diagram, I've labelled the states and the state changes. Here's the particle model diagrams too, just for completeness. The graph remains horizontal for changes of state as we cool our substance because bonds are being reformed, and forming bonds releases energy, helping to maintain the temperature. So even though the temperature has been dropping, as those bonds form, it holds that temperature constant for a while by releasing some more energy. One final point to be aware of is that we're treating our particles, our atoms and molecules, as though they're tiny solid balls like marbles or ball bearings. It's a model which works pretty well to help us understand what's happening, but it's not really the whole story. To learn more about the structure of atoms and how they're actually not like marbles, please click on this link.
lightning round.
Matter is made of tiny particles we can represent as little balls, although this is only a model and not quite right. But it'll do. The particles can bond to each other. In a solid, they're neatly arranged and touching, vibrating on the spot. In a liquid, they're still touching, but moving over each other randomly. In a gas, there's big gaps between them, and they move rapidly. The warmer something is, the more the particles are moving. Heating and cooling lets us change from one state of matter to another. Heating melts a solid into a liquid, and evaporates a liquid into a gas. With a few substances, we can skip the liquid state and jump straight from solid to gas. This is sublimation. Cooling condenses the gas back into a liquid and then freezes the liquid as a solid. If we plot temperature against time on a graph, we get zero gradient sections for the state changes because breaking bonds as we heat takes energy and reforming bonds as we cool releases energy. These zero gradient sections are how we determine exactly what the melting points and boiling points for a substance actually are. I hope that video really helped you. If it did, it'd be great if you let me know in the comments. Remember to like, subscribe, and hit the bell to get a notification the next time I upload a video. If you check the description, I've got links to my revision guides, to Snap Quiz, that's my revision website and app, and to succeedschool.com. That's my website with full lesson plans, schemes of work, and end of unit tests for both teachers and students. I've also got links in the description to my Twitter, my Instagram, my Patreon if you want to support the channel, and there's links to my other YouTube channels, Not School and Not School Plays. You can also click just here to subscribe to this channel, and you can click here to check out this related video. Good luck in your GCSEs and IGCSEs, and thanks very much for watching.